So we did some works yesterday, Sunday, and we talked about one thing that is needful. And part number one, or one thing that was needful, is we need to build a relationship with the Lord. I want us to pick it up from there and just go to part number B of one thing is needful. And we are talking about authenticity. Be an authentic person. Be authentic. Be authentic. Be an authentic and a passionate disciple or a follower. If you go to Numbers chapter number 13, verse number 1 to 3, I believe you have your Bible ready for this journey. Numbers chapter number 13, verse number 1 to 3, the Bible says, "And the Lord spoke unto Moses, saying, Send thou men that they may search the land of Canaan, which I give unto the children of Israel. Of every tribe of their fathers shall you send a man, everyone a ruler among them. And Moses, by the commandment of the Lord, sent them from the wilderness of Paran. All those men were heads of the children of Israel." Be authentic. Be authentic. Be authentic. So, Numbers chapter number 13, verse number 1 to 3 is the scripture that introduces us to the vision that Moses had when he was sending the children of Israel, of the 12 men, to go and spy the land. And the Bible says that the Lord spoke to Moses concerning the land and said that pick men from the 12 tribes and let them go, that they may be able to see the land that I'm preparing for them. Then they'll bring back the report. And from Numbers chapter number 13, that's where we encounter two groups of people. We encounter those that came with a good report and those that came with a bad report. And it's from Numbers chapter number 13 that also we are able to see the life of Caleb. From Numbers chapter number 13 onwards, you realize that God starts speaking concerning this young man by the name called Caleb. And I believe that Caleb is bringing on board things that are very, very important to us today. Caleb has no title. Caleb has no prophetic gift. Caleb is not moving in the reins of laying on of hands. He's a common guy. He's a normal believer, you and I, but he's able to do great things that the Bible is able to recognize. An ordinary but an important person in our discussion today. Caleb actually takes us to the school of loyalty that is missed in the 21st century. And I want us just to look at the life of Caleb in today's lesson and to understand three things that are very, very important to us today. Number one, Caleb is showing us that it is possible to follow the law and the Lord's anointed faithfully. Number one, Caleb is showing us that it is possible to follow the law and also follow the people of the men and the women that God has anointed in our generation. Remember last Sunday we dealt about the subject wholly following the law, and we discovered that Caleb was able to follow the Lord with all of his life, with all of his strength, with all of his mind, with all that is called his own. But Caleb is also able to tell us that you can not only follow the Lord faithfully, but you and I have the ability to follow the men and the women of God that God has appointed or anointed in our lives. A man by the name called Tony Tenney, in his book, Chasing God and Serving Man, says that there are two people. One is Martha and another one is Mary. You remember the story about Martha and Mary? And Martha was given to serve in the issues of, let me call them, the flesh. She was given to prepare the tea or the food that was there in the house. And the Bible says that Mary was given to sit at the feet of Jesus. And Jesus says that Mary has chosen the best thing. And Tony is saying that, you see, Mary has a heart that ministers to God, and Martha has an ability that ministers to humanity. And Tony continues to say that we need to come to a place where we are like the Shunammite woman. I believe you understand the Shunammite woman that perceived that there was a man of God. And he says that the Shunammite woman had the heart of Mary. The Shunammite woman spoke about this man of God who had the calling of God. But the Shunammite woman also had Mary's ability, and the ability was to prepare the room, to prepare a place for the man of God. So he says that therefore we should have the heart like that of the Shunammite woman, who has Mary's heart, ministers to the divine, but mother's ability that ministers to the human part of the human being. So Martha served, but Mary worshipped. The Shunammite woman had the ability to minister to the man of God as a man, but also had the ability to minister to the godly aspect of the man. It is possible. Please don't forget what you are saying. You say that it is possible to minister to God, but it's also possible to minister to the people that God has placed as the anointed men and women in our lives. Please understand that it becomes easy to minister to God. Remember that God has no flaws. God is perfect. I mean, the Bible says that God is not like a man. When he speaks a thing, you are sure that it comes to pass. God does not sleep, he does not slumber. God does not need to be reminded of his promises. His promises, the Bible says, his promises are yes and amen. But to be able to minister to a man that has flaws, it takes the grace of God. Remember, he's a man like you and I. Moses was great, but he had flaws. Noah was great, but he had flaws. Peter the apostle was great, but he had flaws. You and I, we have problems, we have issues. So most people have find it easy to minister to God, or find it easy to give themselves to God, because God has no flaws, but find it very difficult to minister or to give themselves to the Lord's anointed, and because they realize that the Lord's anointed is a man or a woman like you and I. Caleb is a breed that we can learn about today. A man that not only followed the Lord, but a man that passionately desired, showed that he can follow human beings with all of our lives. A man that sleeps like you and I. A man that eats like you and I. Yet God expects of me to follow them. God expects of me to passionately follow them. You see, when Moses was picking the 12 men to go and spy the land, he expected that these men will have his spirit. He expected that these men will follow him. But interesting, as I've said, there were two groups of people that came. The 10 that came with a negative report, they saw the giants. They saw themselves through the eyes of the giants, and they saw negativity in the assignment that God had given to them. The two that went, they saw the land, they saw the giants as food. They saw God's enabling hand to give them the land. The two men, Joshua and Caleb, they connected with the heart of Moses. They connected with the dream of Moses, so that any negativity became a possibility. Ladies and gentlemen, when you have been given an assignment with God, please don't break the hearts of the people. See what God is seeing. The 10 people were not seeing what Moses their leader was seeing. They were not seeing what God was seeing. As a result, the Bible says, many of the people, their hearts were broken because of the report that came to the camp. Yes, they went with the blessings of Moses, but when they came back, they did not come back with the spirit that Moses expected them to return with. They returned with a negative spirit. They saw negativity. They saw impossibility. But thanks be to God for Joshua and Caleb, because they embraced the spirit of Moses. They said, we can still serve God, but can still connect with the man that God has given to us. God has given us Moses, so we can connect with Moses and bring back a report according to the spirit of the day and according to our leader, Moses. Most churches are not moving the way they are supposed to move, because the people that are sent to spy the land, when they come back, they come with a different kind of spirit. They don't come with the spirit of Joshua and Caleb. Yes, there are negativities outside there. Yes, there are giants outside there. But at the end of the day, the question should be, who sent us? Is there a God that we believe in? If there is a God that we believe in, regardless of what we have seen outside there, we need to join with God. We need to join with the man or the woman of God and say that we are able to take the land for God in Jesus' name.
The Bible says that two, they strengthen their hearts of the hearers, while the ten, they broke the hearts of the hearers. If you are a leader in whatever department you are hearing, and you are hearing me today, I need you to start analyzing yourself. When you are given work to do you break the hearts of the hearers, or do you strengthen the hearts of the hearers? If you are in the women department, the men department, the youth department, children's church, do you build the hearts of those who hear you? Or do you break their hearts every time you open your mouth? You see, there are some leaders, every time they open their mouths, they break the hearts of people. But I pray that you are able to realign, because when you realign with a vision, when you realign with God, even when there is an impossibility, there is a wisdom of God on how to bring out a matter. You have said that one of the difficult things in the Christian journey is to follow men, motto men. And sometimes the people you are following, you are good in one way or another, better than them, you are better than them. They have worse issues than you. Some of them are weaker than you. Some of them are not there yet in terms of resources, in terms of their elements, they are not there. But God is saying, follow. Every time you see this leader, you see flaws. Everywhere you see flaws. And God is saying, that is the anointed. Follow. So it becomes challenging, therefore, to follow somebody and you feel that this person is not enough for you. According to the physical reasoning, according to the intellect, it becomes easy to follow men who have made it according to what you see. But I believe that things of God are interesting, because there are people who look as if they have not made it, but I need their blessing. Moses, the Bible says that he says, told God that I have a stammer. But can you imagine a stammerer? Yet God picked him up and says, I wish God could have said, okay, I'm sorting out your mess. You're not a stammerer anymore. But God did not sort out the issue of stammering. He told him, you are still the guy that's going to take over the people from Egypt to come. Apostle Paul describes the state, his state, and some of the leaders that are on the face of the earth. In 2 Corinthians chapter number 6, from verse number 9 to 10, he says, some of them are as unknown, yet they are very known. When you look at them, they look as if they are not known. He says, some of them look as if they are dying, and behold, we live. He says, we look as if we are chastened and not killed, as sorrowful, yet always rejoicing. We look as if we are poor, yet we are making men rich, as having nothing, yet possessing all things. Yet these are the kinds of people sometimes that God will tell you, pursue these people. This one has what you need in life. And Paul is so courageous and tells the people in 1 Corinthians chapter number 4, verse 16, wherefore I beseech you, be you followers of me. Paul is telling the Corinthians that please don't follow Christ direct, follow me. It becomes challenging when a spiritual leader is telling you, follow me, follow me, follow me. Most of the people will take it out of context. And I believe that he's picking it up from Jesus. Jesus, every time he picked up his disciples, he told them that follow me and I will make you, follow me and I will make you, follow me and I will make you, follow me and I will make you. Because you've got to follow. Jesus, they followed his divine nature, but they also followed his human nature. 1 Corinthians chapter number 11 verse 1, Paul says, be you followers of me, even as I am also of Christ. I wish he could have said, follow Christ as I follow Christ. I wish he could have told them, please, don't just follow me, follow Christ. But he tells them, as I'm following Christ, do what? Follow me. We have very few people in the face of the world right now that can stand and say, follow me as I follow Christ. And I want to challenge myself and challenge you as a leader. If you're a pastor, you're a departmental leader, I want you to come to a place that you can be so confident that you can tell the people that you are nurturing, follow Christ. As a father, can you stand, or as a parent, a mother, can you stand in your house and tell your children that follow me as I follow Christ? We need to come to that place that whatever we are talking about, we are doing, and we are so confident that men and women can follow us and not get lost on the way. 1 Thessalonians chapter number 1, I have several scriptures. 1 Thessalonians chapter number 1 from verse number 5 to 7. The Bible says, for our gospel came not unto you in one only. 1 Thessalonians chapter number 1 verse 5 to 7. For our gospel came not unto you in one only, but also in power, in the Holy Ghost, and in much assurance, as you know what manner of men we were among you for your sake. Verse number 6. And you became, now look at that. Look at that. He says, and you became followers of us. My goodness. And you became followers of us. We were doing so well that you became followers of us and of the Lord. Having received the word in much affliction with joy of the Holy Ghost. Seven. So that you were examples to all that believe in Macedonia and Achaia. You are followers. You are following us. As difficult as it is, because we are mortal, you are mortal. We are weak, we are weak. But you identified something and you followed us. What am I saying? Caleb is showing us that it is possible to follow mortal men. I bring this to enlighten us and not to bring any confusion in your life. The Bible says in Amos chapter 3:3, how can two walk together unless they agree? When God gives salvation, you've got to agree with the church you're entering into. You've got to agree with the vision of that ministry. You have got to agree so that you can attain that purpose of God in your life and in the church or the ministry that you're setting your foot into. You can never achieve anything until there is agreement. Caleb is telling us that I have connected myself to Moses. Actually, the Bible says in Numbers chapter number 13, I think verse number 30, that when the children of Israel, the ten men was speaking an evil report, the Bible says Caleb silenced them. He connected with Moses. He said, I'm going to pursue what Moses is pursuing. I pray that we raise up men and women in our church that will pursue what we are pursuing. That will be so passionate to pursue what we need. What our leaders are telling us, we will go for it. We will go for it. Church, we can never achieve anything in the 21st century if we are not realigning ourselves to God and to the men and the women that God has placed in our midst. Remember, we're not bringing this to bring any confusion. We're not talking about worshiping men. We're not talking about building our men and women to become gods. We are talking about loyalty. We are talking about loyalty. That this man, his heart and the heart of Moses was so connected that he would be able to speak on behalf of Moses. While they were complaining and breaking the hearts of the men and the hearts of the women, it is Caleb that silenced them and told them concerning the report of God. Say, hey, we are well able to take over the land. Psalm says that blessed is a man whose quiver is full of his sons. They shall speak on his behalf. You see, every ministry, every anointed man and woman needs their quiver to be full so that the sons and daughters can speak on their behalf when the enemy is trying to attack. Caleb is telling us it is possible, number one, it is possible to follow the Lord and the Lord's anointed faithfully. He followed Moses faithfully. He was committed to Moses faithfully. The Bible says that God says that the only two people shall enter the promised land, because from Canaan, from Egypt, only the two believed in God. They believed in the vision of the man of God. They kept on when they were crossing the Red Sea. They believed in the vision of the man of God. When they were staying in the wilderness, they believed in the vision of the man of God. Do you believe in the vision of your man and the woman of God? There will be tough times. There will be trying times. But the question is, do I believe in what the man and the woman of God is saying? It is not enough to connect to God. You've got also to connect with the man and the woman of God in your life. Remember, two cannot walk together unless they agree. It is amazing that in the 21st century, you can have many people, but most of them don't believe in the vision of the house. They believe in the vision of another house, yet they are in another house. For example, you can find members who are in this church, but they believe more in a vision of another church more than this church. Yet they believe that as they continue staying here, they will receive the blessing of this house. Let me tell you, guys, that it does not work that way. If you don't believe in a vision, it's just like when you're staying in your house and you don't believe in the vision of your house and you believe in the vision of your neighbor, the blessing of your house can never prosper your life. This is me today. Number two, Caleb is showing us that it is possible to follow when there is a leadership shift. It is possible to follow when there is a leadership change. Remember the vision. The vision is progressive. Remember that the vision never dies. But carriers of the vision, they exit the world at certain point. If you are the carrier of a vision, there comes a time that you've got to retire. There comes a time that you've got to pass the baton. But Caleb is showing us that even when there is a shift in leadership, I can still follow. Caleb has been following Moses. And Deuteronomy chapter number 34. Go to Deuteronomy chapter 34. Verse number 9. The Bible says, "And Joshua the son of Nun was full of the spirit of wisdom, for Moses had laid his hands upon him." Moses transferring the grace of leadership. Moses transferring the anointing. Moses transferring the grace upon Joshua. So Joshua was full of the spirit of wisdom. There's an anointing upon Moses. And that anointing had to be transferred to Joshua. The Bible says that the children of Israel hearkened unto him. They listened to Joshua because the hands of Moses were laid upon Joshua, and Joshua was full of the spirit of wisdom. And they did as the Lord commanded Moses. There was a transfer. There was a release upon this man by the name called Joshua to lead the next phase. Every time there is a vision, God will guide us on who is to take over when somebody else retires. It doesn't die. There's always an Elisha to take over from Elijah. When things are about to end for Elijah, there's always an Elisha. Sometimes you need to ask yourself, why couldn't Moses lay his hands on Caleb? I mean, the two were qualified. Joshua was qualified. Caleb was qualified. These were people that were following the Lord, committed to following the Lord. But the Bible says, God spoke to Moses concerning Joshua, and Moses laid his hands upon Joshua. So Joshua automatically became the head. There was a leadership shift. There was a leadership change. Caleb is saying, Joshua, you're my brother, you're my sister, you're my brother, but I've discovered that God has elevated you. Joshua, I know you are my friend, but I've discovered that God has taken you to another level. And you discover that did not derail
the loyalty of Caleb towards the leadership.
I've come to discover that when there is a leadership change, most people no longer honor the leader. Especially if the leader was your friend, you are going together in prayer, or everything, you are on the same, you have the qualification, he or she had the qualification, and the twinkling on of an eye, they were picked and you were not picked. You discover that most people in church, bitterness starts creeping in. Most people in church will withdraw their sons. They base their loyalty on personalities and not on office. And because they are basing their ability to follow, their ability to be discipled on personalities, four things will happen to them. Number one, they will, of course, number one is they base their loyalty on personality and not the office. Number two, they will sacrifice their vision because of pride. They will sacrifice their vision. They had a vision of going to the promised land. But because they based their ability to follow on personalities and not office, pride will make them not to humble themselves. I've seen people who have missed it because of pride. I've seen people who have missed the move of God because of pride. I've seen men and women who have missed the vision of God because of pride, just because there was a leadership shift. Caleb is telling us that even when Joshua, my friend, is taking over, I will still be loyal. Wow. Churches go under when the senior is no more, because members can no longer be loyal to the office. Departments go down when somebody else is sitting on that seat, because members of those departments, they say, I am better than so and so. How come they picked so and so and left me out? And I know some of you are watching this morning, this day, and some of us are nursing wounds because you had positioned yourself for a particular post in church and you didn't get it. And it's paining you up to right now. You need to get over it. You need to get over it. Because you're going to miss out what God has assigned for you. Church, you need to get over it. If you missed it, you need to get over it. You are positioning yourself to become the member of the worship team, and you missed it. Please come back and worship God. Position yourself to become the associate pastor, and it's not coming soon. Please come back. I mean, we don't go to heaven because we are pastors. We go to heaven because we are sons and daughters of the kingdom of God. You are positioning yourself for a touch group, and they are not appointing you. So you refuse to go to touch group. Caleb is telling us, even when I don't get it, I can still follow. Because at the end of the day, I must make sure that the person that God has anointed, that is the person that has my key. I've been a worship leader for a while, and you discover that worship teams split when there's a leadership change. Because a kawaida tena guy, a kawaida guy in the worship team, maybe even they don't know how to really teach, but they are picked as leaders. Oh my goodness. You are forced to have choir A and choir B, not because of growth, but because of immaturity. There are churches that are split, not because we needed the growth, but because of immaturity. I told you this is me this morning. Can I be saying that it is possible? Remember, we are on lessons concerning Caleb's life. It is possible to follow. You can choose to follow. Even when you are not the leader, you can choose to follow. Even when Moses has retired and has given you a Joshua, you can choose to follow and receive your blessing in Jesus' name. So if those who don't follow, number one, we are saying they base their loyalty delete or withdraw support when leadership shifts. I remember one day when I was a leader in this church, and you know what they did to me? They withdrew support by switching off the mic when I'm sick. So immediately I pick the mic, they switch it off, and it's a service. My brother, if you're doing such things, you're not hurting man, you're hurting your life. You're hurting your life. If you withdraw support from the women ministry because you don't receive a particular office, you are hurting your life. If you withdraw support from a church, you see a tithe that say, they did not choose me to become one of the elders, I'm no longer tithing. You're not hurting us, you are hurting yourself. When the destroyer comes, he comes in your house, not our house. They will have appointed me as the chief intercessor. You are not hurting us. You are hurting you. It doesn't change. Number four, they lose their portion. Those who don't follow after leadership change, they base their loyalty on personalities and not the office. Remember, move beyond personalities. Move. If you're going to do things on the face of the earth, God will bring to you people. Some of them are weaker than you. And he says, this is your leader. Some of them, they don't know how to pronounce the words the way you know how to pronounce words. I have a friend of mine who was nearly chucked from a church because this friend could not pronounce particular words. When she is preaching, you know, when she is preaching, she is mixing mother tongue and English. And this church is an English-speaking church. So they say, Pastor, this pastor must go. Why? She doesn't know English. Ooh. My goodness. Several attempts to kick her out. Let me tell you, sometimes God will not bring perfect people in your life to help. Because if you needed perfect people, you'll be perfect. But there is something that God is doing in your life, and they are bringing this. Sometimes God wants to show us how proud we are. We cannot connect with certain people. Sometimes God wants to make sure that the pride in our life, the lack of self-control is instilled back in our lives. So if you have withdrawn support in the church because of something, you're hurting yourself. And I don't want to go to the other level where people withdraw support because they have been hurt. That's a subject for another day. A subject for another day. And you discover that if that has happened to you, I want you to understand that there is healing. God can heal you. God can heal you. Just because you have been hurt, God can heal you. You know, it is even said that some people will not take in advice when there's a change in leadership. Wait for the first time when you are I announce that you are the pastor of Pepper Church Gim. You are the senior pastor. Some people the first Sunday want to check how you deliver the sermon. Are you jumping like the other pastor? Are you tall? Are you short? Are you blah blah blah? Why? They don't want to say amen, and people are frustrated. But I pray that as a church, we come to a level that regardless of the leadership change, there are things that will never happen in our lives. We will still follow. The worst kind of people are those that, of course, kill the vision. They don't leave the church, but they are there to make sure that that vision is dead. They don't look at the bigger picture. So they stay in the choir, say, it was my thing, but they are not giving it to me. I will kill this worship team. I will kill this women department. I will kill this men department. I'll make sure that we don't progress. You are a disgrace to the body of Christ. Caleb is telling us, number one, that it is possible to follow the Lord and the Lord's anointing. Number two, it is possible to follow even when there is a leadership change. Number three, Caleb is telling us that it is possible to be a consistent follower. It is possible. Joshua chapter number 14, 10 to 13. Joshua 14, 10 to 13, the Bible says, and now behold, the Lord has kept me alive, as he said, these 45 years, excuse me, even since the Lord spoke this word unto Moses, while the children of Israel wandered in the wilderness. And now, Lord, I am this day fourscore and 5 years old, 85 years old. I am yet as strong this day as I was in the day that Moses sent me. Look at that. He's consistent. When Moses sent me, I was strong. I am still strong. I am still strong today. My strength was then as strong as it is now. To go to war, to go out and come in. Now therefore give me this mountain whereof the Lord spake in that day. For you heard in the day how the Anakims were there, and that the cities were great and fenced. If so be that the Lord will be with me, then I shall be able to drive them out, as the Lord said. Look at what happened in verse number 13. And Joshua, the guy is consistent. Yes, I was following Moses. I still come to you, Joshua. You were my friend then, but now you are my leader. You are the only one that can give me this blessing. Moses blessed us. We went and checked out the land. But now Joshua blessed me. The Bible says in verse number 13, and Joshua blessed him, my goodness, and gave unto Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, Hebron, for an inheritance. The guy was a consistent follower. Ladies and gentlemen, you can choose to become a consistent follower. Consistent in faith. You can choose to be consistent in your faith. The guy believed for 45 years. How many of us are weak in faith? You believe for God for something for a month or for a day or for a week and you leave it on. This guy for 45 good years believed. He was consistent. Joshua Caleb is telling us that it is possible to be a consistent follower. Consistent in my faith. The Lord has kept me. These 45 years, the Lord has kept me. Can you believe God to keep you for 45 years? Consistent 45 years. I am alive today because of the Lord. I am alive today because of the Lord. I have seen the Lord for 45 years keeping me. The guy is consistent in faith. We must raise people that are consistent in faith. If we are not consistent in faith, we are not going to move mountains that God promised us to move. Number two, he was consistent in following. He names Moses, then he names Joshua. He says, I was there during the time of Moses. I am still following you. I am a strong follower. I was a strong follower during the days of Moses. I am a strong follower in your days, oh Joshua. I am consistent. Every time you follow consistently, you receive nourishment, you become strong, always. Are you consistent? You see, as I've told you, that human beings have flaws. I believe that Joshua had flaws, but the guy was consistent. Are you consistent? Are you consistent? Can you come to me and tell me, Pastor, I am consistent. Through thick and thin, I am consistent. Of course, for the 7 years that we have been here, I've seen people who have told me that I will be with you, and now they are not with me. Why? Because to be consistent, you must stick there. You must stick there. You must stick there. And if we can build, we can receive what God wants us to receive, we must be consistent. I must follow. I must follow. I must follow. I told you that there are some people who believe in other mission more than the mission. One time a man of God said that if you cannot be able to follow your church, and you're following other churches, and yet you claim that you're a member of this other church that you're not following, you're lying to yourself. But you discover there are people who can play a watch party of another church even today, right now. Are you consistent? They can like a quote from another pastor, but not their pastor. Are you consistent? Joshua Caleb is saying, I can be a consistent follower. I'm telling you, it's not about being brainwashed. It's about being focused. As a follower, I am focused. Do you know that when you're focused, sometimes even when you pray, we shall hear? One time, somebody was coming here and somebody was praying and said, I thought you are the one who was praying. This person has been consistent. And they are rubbing something. You know, if you are in BCG and you are praying like somebody from another church, that tells something. If you are in this church and in your prayer time, you are concentrating with demons like the other person, you are not a follower. If you are in this church and you are watching this, hallelujah, 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 thank you. Amen. You are not consistent. If you are in part and parcel of this church and you are not interested in your family, you are not consistent. Because our vision is touching families to impact their world. So as we are driving, we are believing God for families that are thriving. And so if you are a man and you are a woman and you care less about your family, you are not consistent with the vision of this house. Today there is meat. I want you to play this thing again. I want you to hear it again. I want you to hear it again. The guy was consistent in following. Consistent. I am stronger. I can still follow. I can still achieve because I'm consistent. Number three, the guy was consistent with the promise. He held unto the promise for how long? For 45 years. He held unto the promise for 45 years. I'm telling you, we have a promise. We are believing God for better things. We are believing God to build a 20,000 seater cathedral. We are holding on to the promise. The guy was consistent with the promise. You see, sometimes we receive so many promises and we don't pursue them. But the guy had one promise. One promise. And his life was changed. One. Not two. One. How many promises has God given to you? And you're not consistent with the promise. You have not built a relationship with the promise. Church, we must build a relationship with the promise that God has given to us. 45 years waiting for one promise. 45 years. You see, if you are a child, you will not wait for 45 years for the promise. But if you know he that promised is faithful, you will wait for it. Habakkuk says, that though the vision tarry, what should happen? Wait for it. It shall surely come to pass. Galatians chapter number 6, verse 9. It says, let us not be weary in well doing. Why? For in due season. Let us not be weary. Church, let us not be weary. There is a promise that God has given to us. Let us not be weary of well doing. Let us keep on serving. Let's keep on ministering. Let's keep on loving one another. Let's keep on praying. Let's keep on connecting with God. Let us not be weary in well doing. For in due season we shall reap. Ladies and gentlemen, there is a due season that is knocking your door soon and very soon. If you do not faint, due season. Caleb is telling us that one thing
One thing that is needful is to be authentic. Are you authentic? Husband, are you authentic? Wife, are you authentic? Mother, father, are you authentic? Child of God, are you authentic? A church worker, are you authentic? Are you what we are seeing? Caleb, an ordinary guy. But he's teaching us that if you've got to receive your portion, if you've got to connect with what God is doing, God will bring a man and a woman in your life, and you've got to submit yourself. See, many people don't love that word submission because they think it's leveling. It is taken out of context. They don't love it. When you tell people submit, they feel it is a yoke. But see, one of the things that the Bible says is that we should submit one to another. Submit one to another. It's also until there is a submission aspect, there's the vision and the purpose of God will never come to us. Until the man submits to God and the lady submits to the man, the vision of the house will never come to us. Caleb is saying, for me to receive my mountain, I had to submit to Moses. For me to receive my mountain, I had to submit when there was a leadership change. I connected. I did not devalue Joshua, because most of us, they devalue the upcoming leaders. Yet we forget that if God has blessed them there, what we have been believing God for years will be blown away. My prayer to you is that you will be consistent. My prayer to you is that you will yield yourself unto that departmental leader, to that fellowship leader, to that pastor that God has blessed over your life, to that man and woman that God has blessed over your life, so that your life can be better. Remember, pride does not help. It doesn't help. Disconnecting does not hurt the person with a mission. It hurts you because you're going to miss the plan and the purpose of God in your life. Remember what you have said. The last scripture, Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. Let us not be weary in well doing. Do not be weary. My brother, my sister, do not be weary in well doing. If Caleb, an ordinary man, Caleb, the only title he received is when he was being sent to the promised land to check it out. After that, there is no prophet, there is no prophet title, pastor title on Caleb's life. But the guy is in the scripture, loaded with things that he has done. You and I, even without a title, we can receive our mountain if we do what God wants us to do. We can receive our blessing if we do what God wants us to do. We can receive our favor if we do what God wants us to do. Most of us, we don't do what God wants us to do because we don't have a title, because we don't have a position, but because we have not been anointed, because blah, 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 blah. Please put that aside. Go back to the scriptures. Caleb made it without a title. You can make it without a title. Caleb made it by believing God, and he saved his generation. His whole generation was given the land, the Bible says, and Joshua blessed Caleb. May it come to a place that the pastor will bless you and give to you whatever inheritance you have been believing God for, in Jesus' name. I want to pray with you. And this prayer I want to pray to many is to all of us, that you will be authentic. You will be authentic. It's my prayer that you will be authentic. You will not be a fake Christian. You will not be a fake husband. You will not be a fake wife. You will not be a fake son and daughter in the kingdom. You will be authentic. Let me tell you, there are blessings that God has for you, but he needs you to be true. You can't hide anymore. Reveal yourself to God. The Bible says that he who hides his sin will not prosper. You can't hide it. You need to give in. You need to release yourself. Say, I'll be an authentic follower.
between you and the women ministry, or whatever department you're in, say, I'll be authentic. Everything that God has assigned for me, I will do it, regardless of who is sitting on that seat. Amen. Close your eyes wherever you are. And then you have just met that prayer before God. God, I want to be authentic. I've listened to Caleb's life. The guy I followed. I want to follow. I want to be so passionate with him and so passionate with the men and the women you bless in my life. Men and women that follow you, I will not miss out. Just make it a prayer today. In the name of Jesus. Heavenly Father, I pray for my brother, I pray for my sister, that will be true to the word of God, true to the calling of God upon our life, true, oh God, to the vision that you placed upon our lives and over our heads, God. True to the fellowship, my God. True to the ministry, my God. As Caleb was true to what he was doing, until, my God, Joshua blessed him and gave him Horeb as an inheritance. My God, I pray that my brother, my sister, we will be true to the vision. True to you, O God. Jesus, you know our hearts more than we know ourselves. We ask you to forgive us for the day, so God, that we have been hypocrites. We have not been true. We ask you as a church, O God, to cleanse us today. Holy Spirit of God, take the call. Cleanse our lips. Cleanse our lives, O God. We want to be true. We want to be true. I surrender to you, Lord. I surrender. Your name be glorified. Your name be mine. Father, I pray that touch this life. Touch this brother, touch this sister. Speak to them. Speak to them. Touch this husband. Touch this wife, that this son and daughter of this house. That our families, oh God, will not go under because we don't have authentic marriages. Help us. Help us, Jesus. I thank you because this week, my God, marriages are going back to the drawing board and realigning things, closing every door that has caused the enemy to play with their lives and not them. They have not received an inheritance. Jesus. Ministries in this church, the women, the men, the children, the youth, the Lord have had members that are not authentic, they are going back to the drawing board. Yes. Because we want to impact the world. We want to impact our lives. We want to impact the neighbor's lives. We want to impact every ministry. Blessed be your name. If you're here and you're not born again, I want to pray with you. Repeat after me, Lord Jesus. I ask you to forgive me. I ask you to cleanse me. I believe with my heart and I confess with my mouth that you are Lord. Thank you for saving me. Thank you for cleansing me. In Jesus' name. Amen. Heavenly Father, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you. We thank you for your favor. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your ministry, my God. Help us to be true. According to your word, as believers, as Christians, help us, oh God, to be true. Lord, as we start our journey today, we thank you that we shall not miss out our inheritance. Because, Lord, we choose to be true. We choose to walk in the truth. We choose, oh God, to manifest the scriptures. We choose to be the light, oh God, wherever we are, oh God. Thank you, Jesus. We declare that this week, the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit is upon our lives. We are the blessed of God. We are the favored of God. Be thou glorified and be thou magnified. We do commend ourselves to you, to the work of your grace that will able to build us and give us an inheritance among those who are sanctified.
In Jesus' name, we pray, believing and trusting. Amen and amen. Well, may the Lord bless you. May the Lord favor you. May the Lord make his face shine towards you. And may he give you peace. In Jesus' name. Amen. Shalom, shalom. We love you. God bless you. Amen.